To begin with, we have to determine what the problem actually is, if indeed it is a problem. Because there are many occasions when a full table scan is what you want, it's going to be the fastest way to run any particular query. Full table scans can most definitely be your friend. And in any case, is it the table that's long, or is it the scan that's long? Those of you who work with Exadata will be very familiar with this and the various techniques of pushing the cost-based optimizer towards full table scans when it really doesn't want to do one. Never forget, in the Exadata environment, it is only full table scan and index fast full scan that can be offloaded to the storage tier. It's also the only way to offload bloom filter joins. I mention Exadata here particularly because that is an environment where you may not be able to trust the optimizer at all. But in general, trust Uncle Oracle. If the cost-based optimizer is using a full table scan, then probably that is the best thing to do. If it is not the best thing to do, most likely the cost-based optimizer is making a mistake. Why? Because you are giving it bad information. And the information you have to give it is, of course, statistics. Now, we all know about object statistics, but I want to make particular mention of system statistics as well. Now, system statistics are sometimes forgotten about at a surprising number of sites. So I do want to summarize what they actually are so that you can at least check whether you do indeed have system statistics. Looking at this database here, if I select star from sys.orgstats$, so we're in a data dictionary table here, this is what you want to see. About a dozen rows, and you want to see every row reasonably well populated. So what's this telling me? It's telling me that system statistics have indeed been collected. When were they collected? The collection started at about 1 o'clock and finished an hour and 12 minutes later. So we had over an hour of monitoring the hardware to see how the system was performing. Then we see flags, don't worry about that, and then three figures that are on default. CPU speed, NW is non-workload, IO seek time, IO transfer speed. These figures are the defaults. Heaven knows where Oracle gets those defaults from, but they are often totally inappropriate. The next six rows are much more interesting because these are calculated by Oracle monitoring the hardware itself. So this tells me that even though by default it was under the impression that it would take 10 milliseconds for the IO seek time of the disk that this machine is running on, in fact, we can do a single block read in about 3.5 milliseconds. But particularly interesting, we can do a multi-block read in a bit over 4 milliseconds. So it's taking virtually the same time to read a set of blocks as to read just one block. That's going to be a big push towards the full table scan because Oracle knows that it can read a lot more data per second with full table scan multi-block reads. There's the CPU scan speed, and that isn't relevant to our topic today, but you can see it's a lot less than the assumed defaults. MBRC is the multi-block read count. That's going to be automatically tuned from 10.2 onwards, and it simply means that during this statistics gathering period, the multi-block recount size was typically 6 blocks, which isn't actually very big. And then we see the last two, max throughput and slave throughput. This is the I/O rates that Oracle measured. Up here, we see its defaults, the I/O transfer speed. Units are bytes per millisecond. So Oracle guessed that it could do about 4 megabytes a second. In fact, it could do 15 megabytes per second. And more interestingly, when running parallel query, each parallel execution server could do about 3.5 megabytes per second. And by dividing that into that, you get an interesting approximation for how many parallel execution servers it's actually sensible to run on this box. But then by contrast, look at this database here. This is same release, 11.203, but this is a Linux system that I happen to have around. And if I select star from sys.orgstats$, we see something very different. Half the table isn't populated properly at all, and the part that is populated is pretty disastrous. According to this, yes, we have gathered statistics. It looks as though we gathered them for less than a second back in 2011. What that means is we never have gathered them at all. I only created this database yesterday. Now, this is just default values. Default values, they're all in the documentation that Oracle has assumed. And these machines, mark you, are totally different. Now, this is a fairly powerful Linux box. This one down here is just my little Windows laptop. But Oracle has put in the same assumptions for I/O seek time and transfer speed. And in this case, Oracle has absolutely no idea of how long it takes actually to get data on and off disk. And if you run this simple query on your production databases, you may well be horrified by what you see. Now, I've seen systems where the statistics were last gathered perhaps 5 years previously, you know, when instead of being 11G on a Solaris cluster, it was 9I on Linux. Now, and the statistics have never been gathered since. Why? Because the statistics are not gathered automatically. So that's the first point we want to emphasize, that you must give Oracle object statistics, of course, and there's a scheduled job to do that, but system statistics are also vital. But system statistics you have to gather by hand. Final point on the slide, DB file multi-block read count, that is self-tuning from 10 Julies too, and I'm very glad it is too. I did a lot of experimenting with that with earlier releases, but I never really found an algorithm that let me work out the optimal value for it. But from 11.2 onwards, Oracle tunes that internally through its monitoring of I/O rates, through its use of system statistics.